Bible with you, turn to Acts chapter 24, the book of Acts chapter 24. One day at a time, that's all any of us can do. We're having a special guest tonight. Those of you who have heard the Blakey scene, the guy that plays the piano for them, I guess that's what we call it, Carol. What is that instrument?
Keyboard.
Yeah. But anyway, he's going to be here tonight. And he is an evangelist also, so we just wanted to invite him. You folks come in here and see what it sounds like, and then we'll go from there, okay? And don't forget the 22nd, Sunday evening, 6 o'clock, singing group will be with us. And after the service, we'll have fellowship. This will be the last fellowship until Anniversary Sunday. So I hope you can be with us and celebrate in a special way. I love our fellowships. Thank the Lord for your ladies. You always bring a lot of food. Everything's really good. Okay, well, remember that time, okay? The 22nd, Sunday evening, 6 o'clock. Preacher got up and walked to the pulpit with a patch on his chin. He said, "I'm sorry about the bandage, but I cut my chin shaving this morning thinking about my sermon." A voice from the congregation, Joey, yelled out, "Next week, why not think about your chin and cut the sermon?" I'm Joey.
Is that what that mark is on your chin?
Oh, we'll just stand with us as we honor God for Acts chapter 24. I'm going to talk about three men this morning and three mistakes. If you stay with me through this sermon, I think you will see where I'm going. And these three men describe the circumstances that most people find themselves in today. Three men, three fatal mistakes. Father, help us this morning as we study your word together, and we'll give you thanks. Acts chapter 24, verse 24 and 25. Acts chapter 24, verse 24 and 25. "And after certain days, when Phineas came with his wife Drusilla, which was a Jewish, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith in Christ. And as he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, Felix trembled and answered, 'Go thy way for this time. When I have a convenient season, I will call for thee.'" Now I'm going to talk about three men that the Apostle Paul witnessed to. One of them was Felix, one was Agrippa, and the other one was Festus. You may be seated, and we'll continue with that. You know, it's easy to make a mistake. We sometimes get careless, or we may get forgetful, or we may get in a hurry, or we may just have an attitude of we just don't care. But we can correct most mistakes that we make. That's why we have an eraser on our pencil. That's why we have a thing like whiteout, so forth and so on. But the biggest mistake that anybody can ever make is to leave Jesus out of your life.
Amen.
You can't make a bigger mistake than that. That mistake can't be corrected. We don't have an eraser for that. We don't have anything to make up for that. If we leave Jesus out of our life, then what a terrible mistake that is. And there's no way we can correct it. I want to concentrate on these three men in the book of Acts that made that mistake. Now, each one of these three men found themselves in circumstances that if you look around you today, most people are in one of these three circumstances today. Felix was the governor of Judea. And you know what he said? "When I have a convenient season." Oh, Paul, that's good news. Jesus died on the cross, rose from the grave. You'll save anybody that calls on him. Boy, that's great, Paul. When I have a convenient season, I'm going to call on him. A convenient season. The people all over the world today that says, I'm going to get saved one of these days, but it's not convenient for me to do it now. I'm looking for a convenient time when my kids grow up, when I retire, with this or that is taken care of. I'm just not ready to get saved right now. So I will one of these days when it's convenient. That's the reason 95% of people that reach the age of 60 never get saved, because there is no convenient season.
Amen.
There just isn't any. There are no convenient times. We like the word convenient. You know, we want everything convenient. I know I have my bathroom set up to where I know where my toothpaste is. I know where my razors are. I know where my razor blades are. I know where my deodorant is. I know where my toothpaste is. I know where my toothbrushes are. And they're easy access. And don't mess with them. Amen. And most of you the same way. You like everything convenient where you can get to it. And when I want a little baby, I don't have to search. I know where to go to get my little baby. I want everything to be convenient. Of course can do. But when it comes to salvation, we better leave convenient out of our vocabulary.
Amen.
Just leave it out. Because the Bible teaches us today is the day of salvation. I remember the night I got saved. I didn't know why Jesus died on the cross. I didn't know who Jesus was, to tell you the truth. I didn't know that he rose from the grave. And listen, you can't explain salvation. If you could explain it, it wouldn't be from God.
Amen.
I've been saved for years, and I still don't understand everything there is about Jesus dying on the cross and living a perfect life before he died and being resurrected from the grave. If I could explain it and fully understand it, it wouldn't be God, wouldn't it?
Amen.
But it's all by faith. It's just all by faith. But the night I got saved, I didn't know what was going on. All I know is that I asked the Lord to save me, and everything, the sin just went away, and I had this praise. And I got up off my knees and walked back. There's two or three guys that were with me in the service that night. And I invited them to ask each one of them. I said, would you guys, and I had no idea what I'm doing. I said, if you want to get saved, I'll go down forward with you. I had no concept of what I was doing. And each one of them said no, shook their head no. And one of them, his name was Mark Flinger. And a few years later, after I left home in Indianapolis and living there, went back home and visited. And I was asking about my buddies that I had run around with. And I said, what's that old Mark Flinger? And they said, haven't you heard? He was killed in a motorcycle accident. And even now, chills run up down my arms thinking about he might have went to hell. I don't know. But I've often thought, Lord, I pray he got saved.
Amen.
But he passed up a convenient time. And you don't get too many of those. What could happen? Jesus may come back. You could harden your heart. after the age of 16, 95% of people never get saved because their heart gets hard. They're like the Egyptian Pharaoh. Moses kept going to him, and he kept saying, okay, I'm going to let the people go. But the Bible says he kept hardening his heart. Be careful about hardening your heart. Keep it open and keep it receptive to the Lord and the Lord working with you. I want you to look at Acts chapter 26 and verse 28. This fellow's name was Agrippa. He was a ruler of Galilee. And Paul was witnessing to him. The king knoweth of these things, before whom I speak freely, for I am persuaded that none of these things are hidden from him, for this thing was not done in the corner. And Paul asked him, King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? I know that thou believest. Now Paul was witnessing to Agrippa, the king, the ruler of Galilee. And Paul, of course, is looking at him and talking to him. And he said, surely you know what Christ did. You've heard how Jesus lived that life and all the miracles he worked. He lived that perfect life. Then he died on the cross. 3 days later, he rose from the grave. Surely, King, this thing wasn't done in a corner. Surely you heard about it. You understand what I'm talking about. And notice what Agrippa said in verse 28. Agrippa looked at Paul and said, Paul, you're almost persuading me to be a Christian. You almost talked me into it, Paul. You've almost persuaded me to become a Christian. There's a lot of people in the world today who are almost persuaded.
Amen.
Almost persuaded. Not there yet, but I'm almost there. Paul, you've almost persuaded me that what you're talking about is really true. Jesus really did live that perfect life. Jesus really did die on the cross. Jesus really did rise from the grave. Paul, you almost persuaded me that that's all true. So, a lot of folks are like the man described in the book of James. Thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. The devils believe and tremble. It's not enough to just say, I believe Jesus died on the cross and he rose from the grave. You must put it into action. You got to get it from your head to your heart. And you get it from your head to your heart by asking him to come into your heart, be your Savior, give you a home in heaven, and be your Lord. That's how you get it in your heart, from your head to your heart. Did you know that the devil believes that Jesus died on the cross? And all of his little buddies believe it? Jesus believed that, the devil believes that Jesus rose from the grave. All of his little buddies believe that? And you, this morning, if you could see them, and they could hear the preaching of the gospel, the Bible says they would tremble. They believe and they tremble. But they reject Jesus Christ. They don't want anything to do with Jesus Christ. They have refused Jesus Christ. And they turn their back on Jesus Christ. And no amount of preaching, no amount of loving, no matter of caring, nothing will change them. They've already made their choice. I will not bow my knee to Jesus Christ. Evidently, they almost believe, actually do believe, but they will not receive. That's sad. Wilt thou know, O vain man, that without faith works is dead? Not every one that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Those that are going to heaven are those that have received Jesus Christ and put their faith and trust in him.
Amen.
Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name cast out devils? And in thy name done many wonderful works? Now listen, folks, I've been preaching for 50-some years. I guarantee you this, I'm not depending on my preaching to get me to heaven.
Amen.
I'm not depending on my good works to get me to heaven. I'm not depending on how I live from day to day to get me to heaven. You know what I'm depending on? I'm depending on Jesus Christ and him alone to get me to heaven.
Amen.
Now, Jesus Christ will help change my life, and he will help me in my daily living, and he will reward me for serving him. But my faith and trust is in him and him alone for my salvation. If Jesus can't take me to heaven, I'll go to hell.
Amen.
That's the way I believe. That's where my faith is.
Yeah.
If he can't take me to heaven, then I'll die and go to hell. I put my faith and trust in him. That's where my faith is. Then will I profess unto them, I never knew you, depart from you, ye that work iniquity. We must put our trust in Jesus Christ alone. Almost is never enough. I could say, I almost had an accident. I didn't. The baseball player could say, I almost hit a home run, but he didn't. The football player can say, I almost caught a touchdown pass, but he didn't. You know what almost means? Almost means it might as well be a million miles as 1 little inch.
Amen.
Almost is not enough. Convenient time? Almost. We'll never get the job.
Amen.
Then I want you to notice the third fellow we'll talk about here for a few minutes. His name is Festus. And Paul was witnessing to him. In Acts chapter 26, verse 24, Paul was witnessing to him. And Festus was the one who followed Agrippa as the ruler or king of Galilee. And Festus, when Paul witnessed to him, said with a loud voice, Paul, you're beside yourself. Much learning doth make you mad. Paul, you're crazy. You're coming here talking to me about somebody dying on a cross and rising from the grave, and Paul, much learning, you're crazy, Paul, much learning's made you mad. Where in the world did you come up with this? And the world is full of people who just simply say, I can't believe that Jesus did what he did. I just can't believe that salvation is in one person. I just can't believe that that's all there is to it. There must be something else. I just can't believe that. And so we got three people in the world. One looking for a convenient place. One's almost persuaded. And then the other one just simply says, oh, you're crazy. That couldn't be. It's just not possible. They don't realize that it's God's plan of salvation. And if it was explainable and easy to explain and easy to understand, it wouldn't be God doing.
Amen.
Did you know that unbelief is the only sin that God can't forgive?
Amen.
It's only one. The only sin that God can't forgive. God can forgive you for any sin that you've ever committed except this one. And what is the sin of unbelief? The sin of unbelief is this. I don't believe in Jesus Christ. I don't believe what the Bible says about Him. I don't believe that He is salvation, and that He's the only way of salvation. God can't forgive you for that because it's unbelief.
Amen.
As long as we have that spirit, that attitude of unbelief, God can't help us. He can't help us. We have to believe. Wherefore, now Jesus said this. If you don't believe what the preacher is saying, look it up. Matthew chapter 13, verse 31. Jesus said, I say unto you, I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto me. You mean to tell me that God forgives the sin of murder? Yes, He does. Adultery? Yes, He does. Homosexuality? Yes, He will. Any sin, every sin, yes, He'll forgive. But Jesus said that all manner of sin will be forgiven if you ask for it. But this one, notice, but the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit shall not be forgiven unto men. What is the blasphemy? Unbelief. Refusing to believe that Jesus is who He is and that He did what He said He did. Now, there's no way in the world that I can completely understand it all or explain it all. All I know is God said, you better believe it, son. You better believe it. If any man come to the Father, he's got to come through Jesus. He's the only way of salvation. When we reject Jesus Christ and refuse to put our faith in Him, that's unbelief. God can't forgive us until we come to the place where we say, I will believe and I will receive, and then God can forgive us and welcome us into His family. Some mistakes are more costly than others. Make a mistake in checking an account. Recently, we ordered something and we got a call and they said we can't accept the visa. If we do, there's a tax on it and this, that, and the other. And it was, we ordered from Canada and they said we can't go through this. So we wrote a check and sent them a check. And then later they called back and said, well, it went through and everything's fine. And we said, we'll send our check back. And so they sent the check back and we had to void. We can make a mistake, say we saved ourselves $172. It may cost us a small penalty, but that didn't cost us anything because it never checked. Okay. Make a mistake in driving, it may cost you your life. We were coming back from Campbellsville this week, and I was minding my own business. I wasn't driving that fast. That's the Holy Spirit should tell. But I came to this curve, and this big truck comes around the corner, and he's on my side of the road, so I'm going this way, and I get off the road. And the Holy Spirit began to speak. But he could have been mad. I could have been clear off the road and killed myself. And her too. But thank God I didn't. Some mistakes, you've been all penalties. Some mistakes may cost you your life. But you make a mistake in your life, You make a mistake concerning your salvation. You make a mistake concerning your eternal soul, it's going to cost you forever. You don't want to pay that. My goodness, nobody wants to pay that. If there's anything I'm thankful for this morning, I'm thankful for the fact that my eternal soul is in God's hands.
Amen.
It's safe. It's already been set apart. It's already in His hand. And you do it on this side of eternity. You can't wait until you die and fix it. It has to be done on this side of eternity. Today is the day of salvation. Not tomorrow, not next week, not a convenient time, today. Would you stand with us, please?